Hello, everybody. It's time for us to just come into a little bit of prophetic dialogue, a little bit of prophetic conversation. And so I want you to go ahead and just start coming on, everybody. Let's have some conversations tonight. A lot is happening over the globe. How many of you know that's when God raises up prophets, for prophets to speak? Let me pull this a little bit in because I want to see who's coming in. Y'all know I can't see. I'm trying to God renew my eyes. I want to be able to see. Can we bring it in some? Okay. Hey, everybody. Okay, I see y'all coming on. Hi, Denise. Hi, Janae. Okay. Apostle Ali, how are you over there in London? We pray for you guys to be safe and good. I know the word is going forth in London. Hello, Marcus. Hi, Jonathan. Shalom, shalom, shalom. There is a word from the Lord. There are prophetic, not just a word. We need prophetic instructions. We need strategies. We need people to hear that are teachers of the word. We need people who can speak that has the ability to say what heaven is saying. Hey, Wayman, God bless you. Hey, classmate. Hey, Tiffany, God bless you. God bless you. Thank y'all for coming on. Come on, let's get some real dialogue. We have a lot of apostles and prophets out here. I want y'all to share it. Come on, let's just begin to share this. Let's bombard the airwaves and let's take down all the confusion that the enemy is trying to spew. You know, the Bible talks about how Jezebel had prophets and how she had her prophets spewing and saying things. Hi, Pam. God bless you guys. They was talking and saying things, and there's a lot of voices that are speaking now and that's declaring their prophetic sound. But how many of you know that when the true, pure, holy prophet stands up, they begin to dismantle and disman and begin to speak and cause what God is saying to ascend over every other voice? So if y'all can just do me a favor and just begin to share this, let's just share this. There are some real prophets out here speaking, some apostles that have the word of the Lord. Of course, I am an apostle. Hey, Apostle McDuffie, my friend, how you doing? Apostle, hi. Shalonda, God bless you guys. There are some voices that need to hear the word of the Lord. And I believe God's raising up forerunning voices in this hour, people who have the ability to speak as a forerunning voice. And I just believe that anointing that God has placed upon my life as a forerunner, you know, to be able to share what the word is saying. Hi, Shanae. Hey, Prophet Shanae. How you guys doing? Hi, 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 hi. Hey, everybody coming on. Prophet Hattie, God bless you guys. Come on, let's share. Let's share as we get into this conversation tonight. Hi, Wendy. Hi, Yvette. God bless you. You know, we're praying for you guys to know the word of the Lord, to be safe, to be confident, to be assured in what God is saying, especially a lot of you guys who are prophets yourself or apostles. We know the word of the Lord. We are not taken aback by the things that we see that are going on. We hear the word. Hi, heaven. God bless you. We know what the word is saying, okay? And so we want to make sure that you guys share this because I have some things I want to say prophetically to this audience today and just talk about some prophecies and some things that God is saying. And I believe what he's saying ahead, amen, of what we need to prepare ourselves for. Hi, Apostle Jackie. God bless you. God bless you all the way in Virginia. I want y'all to come on, chime in. Come on. We're going to have dialogue today. Hi, Tracy. God bless you. So come on in, and I want to share some things as we go into this tonight. God is doing some massive, incredible things. You guys have heard it. We know we're in days of resets. We've heard a lot of things, and I want to just download. I have so much in my spirit, and I can't give it all to you at one time, but I want you guys to share it because I want to be able to get this out here that we can just converse, have some prophetic chatter. We can go into these prophetic conversations and conclave of conversations that we can truly now join together with one sound and say what God is saying. Hi, Camise. My niece is on tonight. God bless you all the way there in Jersey. In that cold place, I pray God protection over you guys. Alex, hi, how are you? God bless you. Hi, Deaconess Jones, thank you for coming in tonight. God bless you. Hi, 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 everybody. Oh my God, I'm trying to get my glasses on so I can see. And I wanted to be able to take time and lay some things down tonight because you guys know I've been prophesying for a while. I've been saying some things that God has been saying. I just got to pull it in a little bit. I know they tell me, don't do that, Prophet Cynthia, don't. But I can't see well back there. And so I need to pull it in a little bit so I can see y'all. Okay, hi. Hi, Shamika. God bless you. I just want to say hi for a few minutes, and I want to ask you guys to share. Can you guys go ahead and share, Prophet Jonathan? You ready? Let's get into this. I've been prophesying for a while. I almost feel like, you know, and some of you might also feel the same, you know, I feel as if I'm at one time I saw these things so long ago coming. You know, prophets have been prophesying. We are foretellers. We are those who prognosticate, those who speak. Hey, Prophet Judah. Hey, everybody, come on in. Hey, we are those. Hey, Abaza McDuffie. We are those that speak and prognosticate and say things that comes before time. We're speaking out of eternity back into time. The issue has been for a while is that as prophets are speaking so often, the people become so familiar with the sound of a prophet that when they speak sometimes, people no longer are able to receive. Now, I want to say this because this is important for prophets, those of you who are calling to the office, those of you that God have raised up and are raising up to stand into the office of the prophet. That's why God causes his prophets to sit outside the circles and the audience of crowds of people so that when you speak back into it, they're not so familiar with your sound that they miss the sound of God on your voice print. Sometimes we fraternize and sometimes we sit around as prophets. That's why you just can't talk to just be talking. You just can't jump online and just say stuff to say it. You got to make sure when you open up your mouth that people recognize the distinct separation of what God is saying that is not common to what they hear all the time being around you. There are times sometimes we have to draw back. He'll tell prophets, draw back. He'll tell leaders, come on. When you are called into apostolic and prophetic places, he'll tell you to draw back because sometimes we do a disservice to people when we're just talking to talk and we're not really opening up our mouths at that moment to say, thus says the Lord. You know, the Bible says that these prophets, you start reading about prophets and all the prophecies that have come forth in the days of old. You know, they will hide themselves. They will go and separate themselves. Jesus will take walks and be by himself. There has to be that you understand that God is not wanting us to come to the place that we become too familiar with what God is trying to say to the body of Christ and to he's speaking back into the earth, that it becomes, we become so dull in our senses. We become dull in hearing. We fall asleep because it becomes like a lullaby and we no longer are on the cutting edge of hearing what God is saying. And so I want you guys to share it. Can you just please share this? Because in 2012, I began to prophesy a word. I want to share some things with you tonight because tonight I just for a few moments want to talk about the unusual church, okay? We've been talking about these things about the days ahead that it will become church unusual, not church as usual, but church unusual. And the prognostications and the things that prophets, the voices of God had been declaring for a while. We can go back 20 years, some 10 years. I know some things I'd prophesied. I went to pull back prophecies that I had spoken in 2012. And the Lord began to speak to me because every year I give a word of the Lord for that preceding year, what God is saying. And so in 2012, I began to prophesy a word and declare what God was doing, okay? And so what he said in 2012, I prophesied this and I said, the mark of a new era has begun. 2012, I'm gonna just take some highlights because I want you to stay with me tonight to hear what God is saying. In 2012, the Lord said it was the year 5772 on the Jewish calendar. It represents governmental rule and order. Okay, 12 is the number of government. It represented governmental rule and order. New and unexpected laws, I prophesied, will be legislating, shaking people and creating panic in the hearts of many all over the earth. Our government shall become more wicked, revealing the Antichrist spirit that is in it. Hello? Persecution will come to the people of God to challenge the confessions of faith that we stand on. Okay, listen to that highlight. Then we come down here in another part that I said this, I highlighted a few things here. It says, and it would be a year filled with many unexpected events. Only through the Spirit of Christ will you be able to see what the enemy has hidden from thee. Now, that's funny because as we came into 2020, God began to talk about opening up our eyes. That only through the Spirit of Christ, only through the revealing and the opening of your eyes, will you be able to see in this season and in this hour. As we came into 2012, marking us to 2020, God begins to move in another form of moving, and it was governmental. And he was trying to help us understand as we prophesied that these things were coming. He says, you're only going to see through the Spirit of Christ. You will be able to see what the enemy has hidden from thee. Know no man by the flesh, but only by the Spirit, because deception will cloud the decisions of many. Deception, we shall surely see, as leaders speak lies to cover their wicked deeds. Trust not in the flesh of men, because you will be led astray, never to recover or discover a new way. It is time for us to draw near to the Lord Jesus Christ like never before, because the spirit of fear will speak loud and clear to torment minds, telling you lies by whispering in your ear. Be very careful about who you attach yourselves to because of the traps that will be awaiting you. This is 2012. I went down again. I'm going to go down some more. I'm going to skip. It says it's a time of separation and sanctification unto him as his glory is being poured out on many. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy and see the manifestations of creative miracles in this kingdom era. As kingdoms fight against kingdoms and nations against nations, the sound of war will be coming to America's soil. Economic issues will get much worse, and many cities will lose their churches. It's a time to store up and spend less and trust God to give you the best. All of these things shall surely be. The end will be close, but not yet. You will see. I prophesied this in 2012, and I had to come back and read some things, because sometimes we get the word of the Lord and sometimes it becomes dull in our ears and we become like people that just want to hear what is next, and we are not even taking in what God has already said so we can begin to see some things that God has said. Position ourselves. There is no reason why the world should be telling us what's next. We should be in a position to already decree and declare, mobilize an army, get our people in the households of faith, no matter where they set us, that the church begins to rise up. The church begins to rise up, amen, and become the force God has called us to be in the earth. So listen to this. 2:13, I prophesied. Expect the unusual to become usual. For the things that have been difficult to become easy for my people. I shall pour out grace and mercy for the unsaved. Your loved ones and friends will experience visitation of my glory, Asha, that will lead them into the ark of salvation, says the Lord. Look towards the harvest fields, for they are ripe and ready for the taking. Send the laborers now to gather in the end time harvest. The harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. However, the few shall become mighty in my spirit to pull down strongholds and destroy the works of darkness. The remnant of my kingdom has been marked, and they shall go forth in supernatural power. Look no more for the many. But gather the few, and I shall pour out my spirit upon them, and great signs and wonders shall follow their lives. And it shall be said, how is it that you were able to accomplish so much with so few? And I heard the angel of the Lord say to tell them, my righteous remnant, the spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed and qualified me to preach the gospel of the good tidings, and to the poor, and to the afflicted. And he has sent me to bind up and heal the poor. Come on up in here and afflicted. He has sent me to bind up and heal the brokenhearted, and to proclaim liberty to the physically and spiritual captives, the opening of the prison and the eyes of those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, his favorable year. Amen. I want to stop, and I want to stop right there for a moment, because I want to take a moment and I want to share with you some things that God has spoken to me to give you on this evening. Amen. Amen on this evening. Okay, let me see how I can see this. And I pray y'all are with me. Are y'all getting this so far? I want to tell you about this unusual church that the Lord has been speaking about for a while. And I begin to ask the God, how are you going to do this? He said to me that these are days. He said to me, oh my God, Abba Shah. He said, I've said many times, the way we have done church has changed, because we've come into days of transformation. We've come into days of transformation. When we came into 2020, God began to declare some things over us. As I read this word and you see the succession of the word that God was speaking from 2012, ushering us into a new era, into a new decade, into this new time, this new dispensation, God has been trying to prepare us. And he's been trying to awaken the prophetic, those who are called prophetic gatekeepers, prophetic intercessors, to really be able to ascend back into these spirit places and begin to call those things that are out of the spirit back into the earth. God has been shaking and doing some things over a period of time. And so he said to me, we have seen many things that are coming in these days that we have seen. These are the days of the transformation. We are in days of prophetic awakenings, people of God, like never before, that would usher us back into the presence of God. The Holy Ghost revivals and supernatural moves of the Spirit are upon us. This move is happening in you and not just around you. So you are in days where God is doing a move in you. And that's why you're feeling the discomforts. That's why you're feeling the things that won't let you be still. That's why you're being aggravated. That's why you're feeling the frustrations, because the Spirit of God has been trying to bust out of you. And what we have been bound in, God began to speak to me. He says, the church has been serving me sleep and in captivity. The church has been in bondage. We have been asleep, and we have been up under Pharaoh's ashakaraba. We have been up under Pharaoh's system that have kept us into a place of bondage. We've been singing praise. We've been singing and we've been declaring things in this place of the Spirit that has not been by the freedom and the liberty of God. We have been being dictated and how we will serve God. You know, the first thing God told Pharaoh when he was getting ready to bring his people out of bondage and captivity, out of Egypt, right? Out of the systems of governments, out of the strongholds of these strong cycles and systems that have brought his people in captivity. The first thing God began to say to him, he said, Pharaoh, let my people go that they may come, what? And worship me. That thing that Satan did, even when he tempted Jesus on the mount, the Bible says after 40 days, come on, the cycle of a 40 period cycle, Jesus was led into the wilderness by the Spirit. The Spirit of God led him because he had to conquer the gates of hell. He had to prove to the enemy, as he came to now tempt him in every aspect of temptation, Jesus Christ was gaining leverage back for us from the enemy to give us back the ability to overcome the things that the devil would come against us with. And so now we're in days when the Pharaoh systems have raised their head up, and these systems again brought us into captivity because they're holding us bondage. The Bible says that Pharaoh, when he went into this place, they went into this place, Israel, into this place of captivity. You saw that what he was talking about when Joseph went in, he sent this boy named Joseph ahead of time. Joseph went in because Joseph had to now go into a place that he was being positioned to be able to recover his brothers during the time that famine would come. So we're in these days that we're seeing the word of God being fulfilled all around us in these shakings, because God is getting ready to do something supernatural for his people. Since Pharaoh could not let his people go, God began to send shakings to Pharaoh's house. God began to shake every system, every economy stream. God began to speak to the kingdoms of this world and say, you will bring my people out because they are worshiping things that is not of me. He says, let my people go that they may return back to worshiping me. Shekah. Not just coming back to a song. Not just coming back to lifting your hands. Turn their hearts back to a place that they will worship me. And so these systems, these Pharaoh systems, what is this Pharaoh system? It is a place that we find ourselves being captive to systems of mammon. We find ourselves being captive and being held in captivity because the Bible teaches us in what Pharaoh did. You know what he did to the Egyptians? What he did to the children of Israel and brought them into Egypt. What he actually did to them, he was trying to bring them up under a stronghold because he did not want these people to have the ability to worship their God. He kept them busy. Dr. McDuffie, Apostle, you on here. You said many years ago, if the devil can't make you, if he can't get you to disobey God, he'll keep you busy. And so many of us have been busy in Pharaoh's Egypt systems, performing and doing things in the Pharaoh systems that it has taken God's space. It has taken God's place. It begins to take your worship. When he met him on the mount, Satan said to Jesus, he said, if you will bow down and worship me, I'll give you. He was showing him the kingdoms of this world that he had possession of. He said, if you just worship me, you know what I'll do? He's after your worship. He says, if you just worship me, I'll give you. Let's make an exchange. Give me your worship and I'll give you a new car. Give me your worship and I'll give you a bigger house. He was saying, give me your worship. This is what he was saying. Oh my God. He was saying, let's make an exchange because I know you are concerned about your sustainability. See, he tempted him in his flesh. He came to tempt him in what he physically could bring against Jesus. He tempted him in his provision. He tempted him because he was trying to get Jesus to walk in a place of fear, that he did not believe the word enough that he was going to sit in the sound of the enemy. But what he did not know is that Jesus had clear identity. Jesus was not without identity. He knew his assignment. He knew what he was in the earth. He knew who he was. He knew what he was called to do. And he didn't defeat the devil by nothing. He only spoke the word, because the word had all power. It had all authority in it. It had the voice print of God. The earth understood the word, because God formed everything with the word. And he said, I don't even got to go in my emotions on this. All I'm going to do is speak the word. And the Bible says when he began to speak the word of God, and the devil saw there was no opening for him to now be Lord. There was no opening. He could find nothing in him. He left him. The Bible says he left him and went away. I can tell you this tonight, as I begin to speak this word of the Lord, I want to tell you this tonight, that God is shaking the kingdoms of this world because his people have been in captivity. God is trying to get his people out of the captive systems of the world. The kingdoms of this world, the Bible says, shall become the kingdoms of our Lord and our God. And when he began to speak this word to me in 2012, and he was talking to me about what we was moving in now called government. This word called government. Government are terms that we deal with when we start talking about apostolic functions, when we start talking about movement and activity. God, kingdom moving among the men of God. The Bible talks about the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God moving in the earth, moving supernaturally, but moving in the affairs of his people. And so now God is saying to us, as we see these shakings that are happening, God is shaking his people out because he has a purpose for why the church has to be awakened now. He has a purpose for recovery. He has a plan for what he needs to get accomplished, and his church is asleep. His church not only has fallen asleep, the people of God have fallen asleep. The people of God begins to now become attracted. The people of God, not knowing who they are, begin to buy into the voice print of the enemy, and they leave openings for themselves to leave their original place, authentic place of worship in God. Amen. Their hearts being yielded to God. Their hearts in complete surrender to God. Their hearts. Come on, he's talking about your heart. Your heart coming into place of participation with God. He said they left those places and they begin to yield their hearts over to the wrong things. They begin to now create things to protect and provide for themselves. Jehovah says, do you not know I'm your protector and your provider? Why is it that you keep running to the other gods to provide and protect you? He says they're going to offer you things that looks like, oh my God, for a season it's going to feel good. For a season it's going to look as if it's giving you protection and provision. He says, but I'm telling you, as you keep running to these things, they're taking you away from me. My original intent for putting you in the earth was that you would demonstrate the power and God on the earth. Come on. That he put something in earthen vessels to take dominion over the earth. And what we've done, we've hidden ourselves. We found ourselves out of place. And so now the shakings are happening. You know, the story talks about Jonah. You know when Jonah was running from his prophetic purpose and God had sent him to Nineveh? He sent him to go and confront some strong, heavy spirits. Nineveh represent this place of rulership. It represented this place where people was, it was giants. It looked so big. They economic systems was flourishing. It looked like everything was happening. God told Jonah, go give these people a word. Jonah felt like, you know what, surely they too big. They're not going to listen to me. They don't want to hear what I have to say. Some of you are in places right now and God sent you there not to get lost in it. He sent you there to take a word. He sent you there because you had a prophetic voice that you was able to bring a sound. Come on. In some of the places God have sent you into. You got to know your prophetic purpose. You didn't go there to get lost, to get eating on the leeks and the garlic and the onions, to get caught up in what they were serving. He said, I only sent you there to take a message. I sent you there to recover my sheep that have been lost in the systems of this world. I sent you to recover souls. I sent you to regather people. He says, but what happened? You start drinking, come on, the wine of the enemy. You start getting drunken off the king's delicacies. You was eating stuff that you shouldn't been eating, drinking stuff you shouldn't been drinking. The next thing you know, the sound of God becomes dull in your senses and you can no longer hear God. And God said, if I don't shake my people out of the places in which they've ran to try to create a false sense of protection and provision, I will never see what it is I put them on the earth to get accomplished. And how many of you know that's not going to happen? That's not going to happen, because destiny is marked over your life. Destiny is marked on your name. Your great-great-grandmama was praying for you. Your great-great-granddaddy was calling your name. You are marked in the generational bloodline for such a days as this to bring a prophetic shift and a change. And God is shaking everything in your life that has tried to hold you captive. He's moving everything that has tried to block you from seeing the great I am. So we are in these incredible days, because as I prophesied in 2020 about these shakings that was going to come, and God was saying that was going to be a move of his spirit. So he spoke to me and he said that this move, y'all listen to me. He says, this move ain't happening around you. This move is happening in you. Tell your neighbor, somebody just put, it's time to move. He's been saying it's been time to move since we were in 2010. I did a conference, a women's conference, and I began in 2010 to prophetically declare it's time to move. God began to speak to us. We heard the sound go around the earth because verily I say unto you, and verily I say unto you, it's time to move. And so when we hear God speaking, it's time to move. You know what we do? Because we're not in the spirit, we begin to get mad because we want things outside of us to move that ain't moving, because we are the move to make it move. And sometimes you're so frustrated and aggravated, and if God don't begin to disturb the things in you, come on, you'll never step outside of you and disturb the things that are keeping people bound, holding up what God wants to be released, that you are a part of the move for. You are the move. The move is happening in you. The revival is in you. You are the one that have come to reset things. He says, when I look to replenish the earth, I come to my people. When things become chaotic and they get out of order, come on. He says, I've called my people to put it back into original perspectives. It is in you. You are the move. You are the move. Somebody just say, I am the move. I am the move. You are the move. You are the move. And this is the season and the time that God is bringing a move to your door. He's making things move so you can become the move. Oh my God. So he began to speak to me and he says that this move is not happening just around us. It's happening in us. Isaiah 61 says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed and commissioned me to bring good news to the humble and afflicted, to bind up wounds of every broken heart. Now, I just want to stop right there. We talk about in Isaiah 61. We know God is speaking clearly, Isaiah 60 is 61. But I want to talk about Isaiah 61 just for a few moments, because he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Why is the Spirit of the Lord is upon you? Because you've been anointed. What you've been anointed for? He says, I have anointed you and commissioned you. In other words, you've been anointed and appointed. In other words, heaven is backing your sound. God is saying, I put something on you that's just, oh my God. He says, what I put on you is an anointing on you to go and do what? He says, I need you to take good news. I need you to take the good news to people who are truly humble, but they are in bondage of captivities. These people who are needing and waiting for you to bring a sound to them, that they will be awakening to come back and be recovered back into God. He said, I sent you into Egypt for a purpose. The reason why I sent you and gave you that job, the reason why I opened that business for you, the reason why I gave you the ability to accomplish that, the reason why I'm giving you witty ideas right now, the reason why I've been talking prophetically about these new paradigms and business entrepreneurship. He says, why? Because I'm sending you back into some places, just like I sent Joseph. I sent Joseph ahead. Why? Because Joseph had to be in place because there was an economic shift on the horizon. God had to tear down systems in order to reboot them the way he wants them. And he sends people ahead because some of you have been given witty ideas. You have been given business, all different types of business ideas that are coming to you now, because we're in a new dispensation where God is resetting economies. Why do you think they're talking about economic things right now? We got to get strategy to move in what God is showing us so we can be in position ahead, so we can hold the gates open for our brothers and our sisters. Why? Because these are the days that God is bringing us back into unity of oneness. He's going to cause there to be such a recalibration. We're getting ready to see the paradigms of mind shift. We're getting ready to see new models come out of heaven. We've been preaching this and prophesying this, and some of you are part of a system. Who wrote that? Janae, the rebooting. Yes, some of us are a part of what God is taking down, because you know systems have to be rebooted. God is rebooting all systems, and I promise you it's going dark and then the light gonna shine. Amen? Because darkness is always an announcement. It's a backdrop to the display of God's glory. He's making an announcement and he's using you to do it. God is saying, I'm getting ready to make one of the biggest announcements over the globe. When he got ready to promote David, he says, I'm gonna do it in the presence of your enemy. When God got ready to bring the children of Israel out, y'all not, Lord help me, Jesus, when he got ready to bring the children of Israel out of bondage and captivity, he didn't do it in the closet. He did it in the open. He wanted the enemy to see. He wanted Pharaoh to see that in the midst of all that you tried to hold them in and stop them from having and couldn't give them, he says, I do my finest work. I don't have to hide from you, because God ain't scared. He said, I'll wait till it get dark and I'll bring forth the most brilliant light. I'll cause there to be such a reset and a reboot of my system if I can just get my people to turn their hearts back to me, to come back to original intent, to come back into prophetic purpose and destiny, to come back into original identity, so they can speak back into the earth what the earth needs to awaken, what's in the earth for them to come forth and be a harvest for them. He said, if my people praise me, I'll cause the earth to yield a harvest. And the earth is holding back a harvest because we've lost honor and praise unto God. We've taken a praise and an honor into Egypt and we put it on ourselves. And God is saying again to his people, he's saying, I need praise to come back to me. I need honor to come back to me. I want you to thank me. Thank me for everything I've given you. Make it become now on your lips that people can recognize there is an I am God that's greater than every God that people are carrying in their pockets. The gods that people are calling the sun God, the moon God, come on. The gods that are on our jobs, the gods that are in technology, the gods that's sitting in our home. He says there is an I am God, and that God is the only God that has ability to give you authority against the raging gates of hell. Are y'all hearing me? Against the raging gates of hell. So he's on this mission again. He says, because his spirit is upon me. In Isaiah 60, he's prophesying. And he says, it's to bring good news. I'm telling you, good news to humble people, good news to afflicted people. I'm going to bind up the bleeding people, the people who are hurting, the people who are lost. Come on. Blessed are those that bring the good news, not the news of fear, but the good news. It is no time like now than to go out and tell people the good news of Jesus. Come on. You was once lost, but now you're found. I was once blind, but now I see. There is a good news that is coming forth in the midst of bad news. God is heralding a good news. And that good news is what catapults us. It gives us strength to rise up in the midst of darkness. It gives us the ability to rise and build again. It gives us the ability to go back and recover and recapture. There is a good news. Somebody's getting blessed right now. People are going down and there's a whole lot of people coming up. Let's not get twisted about what it is that God is saying. He's awakening the church. There is a church, but God is shaking to get the church to move out in the earth. We're supposed to move out and witness the gospel of Jesus Christ, amen, in the world. People are waiting for the good news, and you can't sit it in a building and keep it on pew number 5 and row number 7. You got to get it out of the building. You're going to have to go out and become the church of power, because that church of power is what demonstrates God's in the earth and then cause people to come back to a local call, a church, so they can be strengthened, so they can be sharpened. See, we fall asleep in church. And the Bible, I was reading about this story about what happened with Jacob and how he had gotten to the place where he was in this journey. You know, Jacob had fallen asleep at this place. He went and put his head on the rock. He had become comfortable. He would meet God at this place. You know, like sometimes we come to church and it's a meeting place and we become comfortable and we want to lay our head down because the church becomes a place that supplies us with what we need. Feed me. Give me what I need. Don't you see I'm great? Give me whatever. And he laid his head down on this rock. And God says the angels begin to disturb Jacob. Oh, shit. The angels, God will not leave you in a state of complacency. God will disturb. Ask Jonah. He tore up a whole ship and shipwreck other people to get him off and to back into prophetic purpose. Do you understand that God will come after your life? He'll burn down buildings for you. Do you know he'll shake a nation for you? Do you know that God is trying to awaken his people? God has shut down systems and government because he's after his church. He's after his woman. He wants his bride to get her heart and affection back towards him. God will shake everything because he's trying to get you. You are what God is after. He's not after a building. This is not about the building. He's after the church, that the church will rise up and become the ministering voices in the earth, that the church will go heal the sick, that the church will go raise the dead, that the church, he says, my spirit is upon you for a reason. I put it on you for you to do the miracle working powers to reach people outside of you. Y'all better hear me, Lord God. He will disturb your life. He will stop everything to get you. And so he said this to me in Isaiah 61. He says that spirit comes upon us. Now, I want y'all to know the difference between the spirit of God on you and the spirit of God in you. Okay, I want you to know just for a few moments, the spirit of the Lord that came upon him. Isaiah said, there's something on me. That something that's on you is not for you. That something that comes on you is for somebody else. What God places on your life is for you to go and be a witness with. What God puts on your life, hear me for a few moments. What God puts on your life, it is for you to go take it to somebody who needs what only they can get, because there's a residue that's happening on you that's spewing from out of you. Amen? There is something God is trying to bring. bringing the earth. And what we have done, he says, the Spirit of God that is on us is for people, but the Spirit of God that is in you is for you. And sometimes we are more focused on having something on us to perform for people than to cultivate the Spirit of God in us. And what we've done in church anity, what we've done in church anity, we focus on what is on us for people. And what we've not cultivated is what was in us. And the Spirit of God in us now that needs us to wake up, that need us to sound the alarm, that need us to open up our mouth and call things back to original intent. The Spirit of God in you, that creative spirit that brought life, that creative spirit that put things back to where it's supposed to be. He says, where is my spirit? Where are the glory carriers? Where are the light bearers? I need the Spirit in you to rise up. And what had happened with us, we sat in church like Jacob sat and put his head on this rock that he called the pillar, that he began to lay down, and he fell asleep, and the angel of the Lord wrestled with him all night because he had to get something out of Jacob. And the Bible says that as Jacob went into this place, as Jacob went into this place, God said, I'm not going to let you go. Jacob said, I'm going to wrestle with you, God, till you bless me. And God said, well, let's go. And God began to do something in Jacob's life as he went into this supernatural place with the angels of the Lord. As he went into this place, God began to show him the spirit of transformation. Can I tell y'all that, oh my God, we got people dropping like flies. We got leaders. Come on. We got leaders that are dropping. People are losing their way simply because we've not cultivated enough of something in us that we don't have the ability when things go haywire to call it back. We don't have enough spirit life in us to resuscitate. We don't have enough spirit of life in us when people show up to the altars, when people are coming hurting in the household of faith, when your family members are going through things, when people on your job, you show up to the church and the church became a place of resting. It became a place that we just lay our head because we just tired. We need God to help us. We need God to do something for us. It no longer became the place of sharpening. It no longer became the place where God can do something in me so it can spew out of me and put something on me for other people. That when I leave the church, I become a witnessing weapon against the kingdom of darkness. We became those that was lullabied in church. The praise songs don't move you. The message of the gospel don't move because we don't went to sleep. We want the church to supply for us. So we became the people. I know I'm telling the truth. We became the people that came to the church. And though we are a resource center, we only came to get resources. We didn't come to be shopping to go out and be the resource for many. And so he talks about in Isaiah 60, and then we see in 61, he's saying, first of all, you're going to have to wake up because there's something that's got to come back on you in 60. So he says, I want to make an announcement, arise and shine, for the light has come and the glory of the Lord, what, has risen upon you. He's saying to us in Isaiah 60 that we have been asleep. We've been preaching sleep. We've been working in ministry sleep. He's trying to wake us up. He's saying, listen, church, y'all been asleep. It's time to wake up. I'm telling the truth. We don't want to do nothing no more. Wake up out of what? Spiritual depression. What is spiritual depression? I'm glad you asked me. Spiritual depression is what the Bible talks about. People who have lost interest. People who no longer have interest in anything that's of the spirit. We become so natural, we're trying to solve supernatural problems with intellectual, natural intelligence. There is a wisdom that comes on man, but there is the higher wisdom that comes from God. There are divine, intelligent places that God causes us to ascend in by way of revelation, that you become the resetter of the systems. Everything that's going chaotic right now, God wants you to open up your mouth and put it back into original place. He's saying there's something that is coming that's waking you up. He says, you know when you fall asleep, you know people come in the room. You ever been asleep and you with your spouse or with your brothers and sisters, and they come and they say, you better wake up. We got to go. Wake up. How many of y'all know when people try to wake you up when you're in deep sleep? When you're in deep sleep, you can't even be moved. People in deep sleep, you hit their leg, pour water on them, they still sleep. Some people have been in deep sleep. Oh my God. Some people have been sleeping so long, they have gotten in such a deep sleep. The shakings that came prior to this, we had a reset in 2008. Every time we see resets are about the exchanging of power and the exchange of money. It's new power players that's been coming on the scene. God has been talking about it since 2008. He brought us in 2012, talked about that there was going to be some shakings that was coming, and it was coming because of the governments of God. What is the government? God's system is being raised up. He's telling you, I'm raising up my system. My governmental kingdom system is being put back place. Well, where are they going to be put back place? In the hearts of my people. I want my people to get my systems. I want them to come back into kingdom spiritual understanding that they can walk in this place of dominion and power and bring things back to original intent. So he's telling you that these are the days of kingdom takeover. Well, what does that mean? That did not mean just preaching a message and putting the tag in the word kingdom on it. That did not mean that we was going to stay the same. Because I keep asking God, how you going to do this? How you going to do this? And he's shaking things. He's saying a shaking was coming. So we saw it in 2008. We've seen shakings come again. Why? Because we're in new dispensations. We're in places where new economies are given birth. Now hear this. Hear this for me. Hear this. If we're in a new dispensation means a lot of things. But one of the words I want to really deal with is that a new dispensation means new economy. Think it not strange that the kingdoms of this world economy that has been Pharaoh systems that has taxed and labor God's people to be in bondage are being shaken. Why? Because the Bible says that when it was time for Pharaoh to let God's people go, hear me, in the time of Passover. Y'all better hear me. And I know some of us are saying this, but let me help you understand something. In the days of Pharaoh, when these systems began to get shaken, because God wanted to bring his people out. The Bible says Pharaoh began to put extra labor on the people. You know why he put extra labor on the people, guys? Because he wanted the people to be so busy that they wouldn't have time to reproduce, because the army of Israel, after Joseph had come through the famine and got his brothers back there, the army began to grow from 70 people that came to Israel, that came back to Egypt, that was with Joseph, that came back to Joseph, his brothers. That army began to grow from 70 people. They went to 430 strong. The pharaohs became so afraid of their ability to take them over. He began to create a slave system. He says, if I just look, let them feel like they're getting promoted. Let them feel like they're getting something. You know, we'll give you a car, but we won't give you everything. You know, we'll let you get one house, but you can't have a whole hill. You know, when we begin to give you some things to appease your appetite, but not releasing everything that's owed to me. God say Pharaoh began to tax the people because fear came upon the hearts of the Egyptians, and they felt like they were having these babies. This economy is growing, because how many of you know, blesses a man whose quiver is full. And that's why we're seeing the enemy hit. Even we're dealing with issues where they're killing our babies. We're seeing now the God of Molech, where we are now dedicating and taking our babies. Did you not think God was going to shift this? Did you not think God was going to shake it? We're dealing with economy. We're dealing with the resources of another generation for the next 40 years that are so important to what God has to do. When we start messing with economy, we're messing with kingdom. When you start messing with God's government, he pulls out his big troops. Hello, apostles. Hello, prophets. The militaristic branch of God that begins to rise up and get back on the gates. Why? Because the gates represents what's going to be a lawful and what's going to be acceptable that can come in. And some of us left the gates and got caught up in Pharaoh's food, got caught up in what he was given, and all he was doing was keeping you busy. You working two jobs, you working overtime. Come on, all he's doing is keeping you busy because he don't want you to produce nothing. And that's what he did with the Israelites in Egypt. He taxed them with so much more because he wanted them to be so wore out, they had no worship for their God. He wanted them to be so wore out, they couldn't go into prayer. He wanted them to be so wore out that when God announces in 2019, now I'm going to cause you to come into new beginnings in 2018, and I'm going to cause you to give birth, he wanted you to be so tired that you couldn't even push. He wanted them to be so tired that when it was time for their baby to come forth, that they so wore out because they've been working so hard trying to get what's already theirs. Whew. And if they had just waited and stayed in worship with God, God said, I'm going to turn it over to you anyway. I'm just setting it up, because when I bring you out, I'm going to bring you out in front of your enemy. When I bring you out and I reset you in what I'm doing, I'm going to bring you out, and I want the enemy to know that in his face, I'm going to cross you over. In his face, I'm telling you right now, in the face of your enemy, God is saying, I'm getting ready to resurrect a church that's going to walk in a place of pure power. Hear me. Hear me. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself because I'm so excited. I want y'all to share. Come on, just share it. Let me see what y'all are saying. Angela's saying, let's get hungry for Jesus. Come on, I want y'all to share what I'm saying tonight. Just begin to share this, because this is so significant for what's ahead. I have some things else I want to tell you and I want to share with you, because this is so significant to what God is saying and what he's doing, so you can see the full thought of God, not a piece of God's thought. You got to see the whole thought of God. We got to get back to legislating on the gates. Economy, legislation, and government takes place at the gates. When you leave the gates, you leave your nation open, you leave your city open, and then the enemy begins to creep in, come on, and seize what is already yours. They begin to take possession and sit up on your stuff and then try to sell it back to you. And this is what Pharaoh began to tax these people so. He began to bring them in such a place of labor. But you know what God did in it? Thank you, Prophet Jackie. You just put labor up there. And that just hit something in me too. Labor, when he began to tax them in labor, look what happened. God was drawing his people to a place called Goshen. Another place that Goshen represents is labor. It represents labor, huh? Ah, shaka. When you labor, he says, that's why he says labor to enter into rest. Labor to enter into rest. Goshen was a place that people had labored to rest. They had labored to rest. And this place of Goshen, but it represents unity. And so when he was bringing these people back to recover economic systems and bless them, he was bringing them to a place called Goshen. Why? Because Goshen represented an intimate dwelling place with God. It represented an intimate, hear me, say it, y'all. Goshen represented an intimate dwelling place with God, where people will cease from labor and enter into rest. He was transitioning them from the Egyptian mindset of working so much that they had no time to be with God. That's why God put the Sabbath in place. He says the Sabbath was made for you. Why? Because there's a time of rest. There is a time that you labor to rest so you can really begin to now appreciate the benefits of what God has done in your life. And God is drawing us to a place called rest. And if you won't rest, he'll shut everything down. He did it on the Sabbath. He said, if you won't rest, I'm going to shut everything down because I'm going to perform miracles in the midst of your enemy. I want my people to enter into Goshen, a place of intimate dwelling with me. I'm turning your hearts back to my original purpose. I'm bringing you out of Pharaoh's systems. Y'all hearing me tonight? I'm arresting. I'm shaking because we done built golden calves. We keep doing it. We go right back to the same thing that they did in the beginning. God said, as it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. They was building things in the beginning. Come on. They began to create a system to provide and protect them out of themselves. And that's why in the garden, when God was walking in the garden, the glory was there. The Bible says that when they took in another thought, come on, he wasn't biting an apple just to bite an apple. He was biting fruit. Fruit that was produced out of hell. He began to chew on fruit that will change your appetite and you will never walk in the fruit of the Spirit because it begins to manipulate your taste buds and make you desire for things that God never meant for you to have. And so in the garden, they begin to eat for unforbidden fruit. They begin to eat things that was produced out of hell. And God said, I never meant for you to eat anything that was produced out of hell. Nothing that was produced out of unsubmitted spirits. I didn't mean for you to eat anything that came out of rebellion. I didn't want you to eat anything that was not in total submission and commitment and agreement with me. He says, but you've been eating stuff because you left my presence, you left my glory and my spirit, and you begin to eat off, and then when you ate it, the devil created an appetite in you that you wanted some more. And when you wanted some more, you left the dwelling place of God, and you begin to take fig leaves and put on yourself in the garden, and you're going to hide yourself. And how do we think in the world, how do we think we can hide from the presence of God? But they've hidden fig leaves, and leaves represented a place of provision. You know, we talk about money. It's a false sense of security. It's a false sense of provision. And so when we look at what those trees represent and those leaves represent, it meant men was going to run and they was going to come into a place where they would try to create their own economy within themselves. And so they put the leaves upon themselves. Are y'all hearing me so far? Are y'all hearing me? Please share. Please share. Please share. Please share. We got people who have been sitting in the perfect place of God, eating from hell. We got people, the Bible says that place that was called Eden was God's place. It was a dwelling place. It was a delightful place. It was a place where the glory of God was with them. They heard from God. Adam walked with God in the cool of the day. Why would you want to leave walking with God and talking with God and spending time with God? Y'all hearing me? Why would you want to leave that and go? Because the enemy made an offer. He began to make you believe that you didn't have everything you already needed to do what you were supposed to get done. He was selling you over into a place of slavery and bondage, and he brought your higher thought down to the thought of average. You was never supposed to be an average nothing. You was never supposed to be mediocre nothing. You were supposed to always walk in the place of dominion. You were supposed to rule and reign over the earth. God didn't make you to be usual. He made you to be unusual, that you walk in the earth and produce an unusual move of God called the Church of Jesus Christ. His church was never supposed to become so comfortable and natural that we sit in his church eating off the appetites of an unforbidden fruit that have made us lost our passion. We've lost our fire. There is nothing stirring in us that we can give to anybody else. And God is shaking. He's shaking the kingdoms of this world. He's shaking everything that can be shaken. Why? Because he's after you. He's coming after you, church, bride of Christ. If you're not a believer tonight, and you may be listening to me right now speak to you, I want to take a moment and I want to let you know it is time for you to come on the winning team. As you can see, at the end, I promise you, we're going to win. At the end, God is going to recover his people. Once again, read the word. It says we win. All the way to the end, it says we win. Darkness was at the beginning. Darkness is going to be at the end. But the Bible says there is a light of God's glory that's always going to outshine darkness. And I'm telling you, if you don't believe in that Jesus, if you don't believe that there is that kind of power for you right now to walk out of every fear place, every stuck place, I'm telling you, God is wanting something supernatural. Come on, people of God. Reba. God wants something supernatural to rise up in you called faith. Just believe. Just believe. Well, you know, it's hard for me to believe God can do any of those things. You know, I just can't believe it. But let me tell you this about belief. Belief sits in your heart, and it causes you now to make a decision. It does not work with facts. It comes from truth. And sometimes we've been in so much bondage of facts that we don't even know how to receive truth. The truth is that you're free. The truth is that you're already whole. The truth is that God has made you an overcomer. These are truths. And when you meditate on those truths, do you know when you meditate on it, you find yourself walking in it? When you meditate on it enough, you find yourself doing it? When you meditate in that place called belief, I just believe. You believe the bank gonna have your money when you go there next week, tomorrow. You believe you put your money in the bank. You believe that that bank gonna have your money. So you're putting your trust in a bank system. You're putting your trust in a Pharaoh system. You're putting your trust, and I'm not against banks. I'm not against stock markets. I'm not against all the things that we do because we live in a natural world and God give us supernatural strategy of how to go and take back. He said we're gonna get the spoils back from what the enemy robbed from us. But what I'm telling you this is that you can't put more faith. You can't put more trust and hope in natural things that you don't pick up your supernatural authority and begin to override things that are natural. This thing in God is supernatural. It's not natural. It's not you can confess with your mouth. He says after you do that, you got to believe. Belief is in the heart. Belief is in the heart. So you got to take all those untruths out of your heart that has just been facts, but they're not truth. And they're making you believe something that God never meant for you to believe. So let's just for a few moments, come on, Shekaraba. I just decree and declare the word of the Lord to every one of your loved ones. People that are on here, I stir up the glory, the anointing of God. He say, fan the fans of faith. I stir you up, O woman and man of God. Come on, you apostles and prophets, pastors, evangelists and teachers, you ministers of the gospel. Everyone of you are called to minister the word of God. You don't need a pulpit to do it. Your pulpit is the earth. Open up your mouth and speak. I'm telling you, open up your mouth and declare the word of the Lord. You are called to be a speaking spirit, to walk in the earth and get God's original voice print back in the earth so the earth can hear it. The Bible says when it hears the praises of God, when you praise God and you honor God with your sound, the earth yields forth an automatic harvest. An automatic harvest is in the earth waiting for you to walk in honor again and yield that sound back to God. And then it's going to bring forth your harvest. That's why he says stay planted. In Psalms, I think it's Psalms 1. He says stay planted by the trees. Stay planted like a tree by the rivers of living water so that in every season you'll bring forth. I don't care what it looked like. Somebody need to get bold enough and say, I'm bringing forth in the midst of this. New ideas are coming forth. Witty inventions are coming forth in this. There is a reset and God is transferring things over into the hands of righteous. And you're going to prove in this season that you are mature enough, that you trust God enough, that you believe God enough. No matter what is happening, God is shaking some things to recover some things for you. He's shaking things to recover them for you. This shaking is your awakening. So you don't miss the opportunities that's getting ready to happen. God is trying to open your eyes so you don't miss the opportunities that is about to come. Hear me prophetically, that are coming your way. So we pray for family members and loved ones. Father, I just thank you for the people that are listening now. I thank you for those, Father God, that have chimed in. Share. I thank you for those that are fearful, and even some that may be, Father, have been diagnosed and even dealing with coronavirus. Can I tell y'all his name is above every name? Can I tell you I've heard testimonies of people who say they were sick and they call on the name of the Lord. They call on the great healer. They call on the one who was the provider. He'll bring people to your door, honey, and bring a bag of groceries. People will send money to your Cash App. People will be out of nowhere. They'll begin to call you and they'll begin to come and bring things to you just because you set your heart back with God. I'm telling you, this is a heart thing, and God is turning your heart back to him. So I prophesy and I decree and declare, you're about to see family members who had turned their ears away from God open their ears and hear what you got to say in this season. You're about to be the greatest minister to your family. God is about to use you ministering agents to go into the earth and take the glory of God to every dark place. Oh, don't run from it. Go into the dark places. Go to people houses, folks that you didn't talk to for years, people that couldn't hear you in prior seasons. I promise you, he says the harvest fields are ripe, the laborers are few, and he's awakening people to pray. Family members are coming into the kingdom of God. So listen to what I'm saying. I prophesied it, and I said it in this prophecy I read to you. Family members are coming. So we just pray. Just repeat after me. Say, Father, I thank you for coming into my life. I believe that you died and you rose for me. I believe it not just in my head. I take those words into my heart. And I make a conscious decision today to turn from everything that I've done before this moment and turn my heart back to you. I decree and declare by the knowledge and the anointing of God in my life, I announce you saved. I announce you now into the kingdom of God. Now it's time for you to sit in God's presence, get filled back up with the spirit and the knowledge of God. Go out and be the first person that now recovered. People on your job, people that are, your family, go be the first witness to them. Tell them about Jesus. Come on, disciples. Let's go take the globe for God in the midst of darkness. Can I tell you this? Let's go here now. The Bible says this. As I was teaching this, and God was sharing this with me, he says people are dropping everywhere. He says people have been losing their way simply because no one prepared us for kingdom, but they dressed us for church. I'm going to say it again. He says people are losing their way because nobody prepared us for the kingdom, but they dressed us for church. Oh, y'all need to hear that. Goodness. We were not prepared for kingdom. All the announcements was coming. Get ready. The kingdom of God is coming. The kingdom is here. The kingdom is here. Don't you know the kingdom? He says it's not meat. It's not drink. It's not what you can put on. It's not. He says the kingdom. Oh, my God. He says it's righteousness, peace, and it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. He says the kingdom is something that moves in the hearts of people, that brings a movement out in the earth. He says the kingdom is moving among us. Why? Because I see people violently moving on the behalf of God to recover what was lost from him. You are a recovering agent. He says, I know the kingdom is among us. Why? He says, go tell them the blind see. Go tell them the lame are walking. Where is the kingdom? Go tell them I was with somebody who said they thought they may have had coronavirus. I did what the kingdom do. It is illegal for sickness to be with us in the kingdom. It is illegal for you not to have your needs met. It is illegal according to our jurisdictional governmental rights that comes with our ambassadorship. It is illegal for us to sit in places of brokenness and despair. Not kingdom citizens. I'm talking to you now because you've been dressed for the church and not prepared for the kingdom. And God is telling us it's time to wake up and get dressed. Come on, get up, soldier. It's time to get dressed with kingdom authority. It's time to get dressed in the spirit of God. It's time to awaken and arise and get dressed with an anointing to go out, lay hands on the sick, raise the dead. He says, now I know the kingdom is among me. Why? Because I see the blind seeing. I see the hopeless with hope. I see people who are lost finding their way. Now the kingdom is among us. Not people sitting in buildings hiding, laying their head on the rock, waiting for everybody to do something for them. He says, no, the kingdom goes and it's a violent takeover. It's a violent takeover. Kingdom brings us not just into this place where we have been so evangelically minded, where we focus on people just getting saved. We've made these churches become gathering places of people just knowing Christ, but we've not formed Christ in them. There has to be the forming of Christ. Christ be formed in you. Let that be formed in you, the hope of glory. That has to be formed in you. You're going to need that in the days to witness God in the face of darkness. You're going to have to know your original DNA that comes from Christ. You're going to have to know the I am. So when Satan comes to bring the same temptations that he brought to our Father, when he brought to Jesus Christ, you're going to have to know what the greater power is that is in you. You're going to have to know today. And so he's telling you, get up and get dressed. He's telling you, get up, wake up, put on something. I'm telling you, go, let your light shine. I'm telling you, I'll put something in you for you. But that residue flows on the outside for other people. And I need the kingdom of God to move. I need you to move out violently. I need you to stop worrying about a building and go get a soul. I need you to understand I didn't die for skin, but I died for souls. I need you to come out of culture. I need you to come out of this place where we've been bound in. I need you to come out of the places of Pharaoh where he stagnated your praise and tried to stop your worship. He said, I need you to come out. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to shake you from where you've been hiding. You ran and you tried to hide yourself among the trees. You're hiding again? You went to hide into the economy of man. You went to hide into the gods of mammon. You built yourself a golden calf. You thought that was going to be enough. Oh my God, help me, Jesus. God said, but I had called you for the original purpose to be the replenishers of the earth, to walk in dominion and power. Y'all, help me, Jesus. So he's saying to us, he doesn't want us to just stay evangelically minded. Some of y'all have become so dull, like Jacob was. Listen while I'm talking about transformation for a moment. The Bible says Joseph ran ahead because he needed to be in place. God gave him a strategy. God gave him a strategy because there was an economic shift coming. And he gave him a strategy. And he began to tell him and teach him how to put things in place. Because what God was going to pour out, he was going to use him to rescue a whole nation. What God is going to do to you, can I prophesy? This is not just about you. What God is laying out in you, it is so important that you get still to hear. It is so important that you draw into this place called Goshen, that you come into this intimate dwelling place right now. Because what God is trying to reset through you and what he's trying to move out of you is that you're going to be able to rescue a whole nation. God is getting ready to download something in your life that has never hit the earth before. And he's needing you to be still to hear it. He's needing you to come out of. That's why he's separating. He's saying, listen. It's too much fraternizing and socializing going on. It's going on everywhere. It's going on in the church. Even when we come home, we're still socializing on social media. We got all this socializing going on, and there is no power being displayed. And God is saying, if I can stop you, because some of us are copying what we hear other people say, we're copying what we see other people do. He says, no, I'm getting ready to arrest you because I have a divine appointment with you. There is something in you have to come forth. Your dream has to live. Are y'all hearing me? What God gave you, your business idea, what God gave you for the next 40-year dispensation has to be birthed. Why? Because the generation ahead are waiting for what God gave you. And if I don't separate you from people you're sitting around, if I don't draw you back into a dwelling place, if I don't bring light back into your heart, you will never see the original purpose. You will pass by the opportunities that's coming with your name on it. You will never walk forth in your dream. You will never become who I call you to be. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to shut down your ability to talk and hear from everybody else. You're going to hear from me in this season. And when you finish hearing from me, you're going to give birth to what I said. He says, you're going to speak that back over the earth. And that's going to give expression of power to who I am and what I said. Are y'all hearing me? Please share. Let me finish this. He says, we've been in this evangelical mode that we have forgotten about the apostolic and the prophetic, but it has always been. Jesus comes and introduces himself to us as a prophet, but when he leaves us an apostolic function, and we left apostolic function. Apostolic function is about bringing us into power. Apostolic function is about bringing us into movement. Apostolic function is about recovery of souls. Apostolic function. He says, we left apostolic function, and we begin to sit in the church again that brought us up under this Protestant mindset that made us now become comfortable in just overseeing what people did so we can just become the maintenance workers. You know, we've just been maintenance workers. We've just been trying to maintain what is happening instead of us bringing new movements in the earth that is giving birth out of heaven. God has been trying to bring things into the earth that will bring moves in the earth through you. And we've been sitting around. Oh, God, help me, Jesus. Woo, help me, Lord. We've been sitting around hearing what everybody else said that we can't hear God. And God said, you know what I got to do? I got to bring you into a quarantine now. I got to separate you. I'm going to make it become now. I'm going to declare it. But what the enemy means for bad, God said, I'm going to work it for my people good. While they're trying to shut you down. You know when the children of Israel went into Egypt and they was working hard? You know the enemy did not understand even when he was tasking them and putting more labor on them and trying to keep them busy so they couldn't push out their babies and give forth. He didn't want them to have no intimate time with each other. So by the time they went home, they were so tired they went to sleep. So they would produce no more children because they kept having all these babies and they got nervous. They said, if they keep having these babies, they're going to outnumber us. And the Bible says that when he was, his plan was to make them so tired, God said, but I was making them tough. I was making them so tough while you was trying to make them tired. God said, I was making them tough. I was creating in them a resilience against you. I was causing them to rise up in a new sound. I was pressing and stretching their capacity for pain so they can give birth to something called purpose. He said, what you meant for their bad, I'm going to work it for their good. And what the enemy may mean for this and that, God is going to turn this thing around and he's going to work it for your good. I'm telling you right now, you just got to draw back into Goshen and come back in that dwelling place. So I'm almost finished. What time is it? My time. Ooh, I'm almost finished. I didn't mean to be here this long, but let me tell y'all this. As he was speaking to me, he said, we got into an evangelical mode where the churches became gathering places where people just sit and they lay their head down and fall asleep and they don't expect nothing to move out of them. They don't even expect a move to happen in the building they in because we've been falling asleep. And he said, we've been asleep so long. We in such deep sleep that the shakings before didn't even wake us up. God said, but this is such a pivotal time that we're in because the time portals are closing. Time that you've known are no more. So that violent shaking now has gone to the next level. He says, you've been asleep and I woke you up and you went right back to sleep. You ever had somebody wake you up and you say, what you want, girl? Oh, what you want? And they say, get up. You got to get up. We got to go. Lay down. Mama say, go back in there. What happened to that child? He done fell back to sleep. And the Bible says that child, he goes back to sleep because he'd rather be in this place of comfort and rest than get up and work. Then get up. That's why he says the harvest fields are ripe and the laborers are few. We like to rest because we don't want to work. And God is saying, these are the days I'm saying, wake up and go into the vineyard because it's a ripening time for you to now witness the souls. And then you find people that when you try to wake them up and they sleep, and they can't get up. He says, well, what I got to do, I got to take the shaking to the next level. It's got to shake you so that you wake up and you know that the shakings are happening because it moved your bed. Oh my God, help me. There are earthquakes that are happening. These are signs. These are things that are happening. They come with plagues. They come with famine. They come with the earth moving off its axle because God is trying to awaken us from out of our sleeping place that we can open up our mouth, come on, and speak back to the earth and bring it back to its original place. It is off its axle. The earth has been off its axle since 2012, and he's awakening us so we can call it back to its original place. I'm almost finished. I'm going to close out because I got a lot to say. I think I'm going to come back and I'm going to give you guys some more because you can only take so much at a certain time. Amen. I got so much to tell you, but God told me to tell you this. He said that I'm causing this church to come out of this evangelical place of just winning souls, that I call you now to cause the Christ to be formed in you, that you become the deliverer of souls, that you're not just about bringing souls to the kingdom, but you're taking the kingdom to the souls. Amen. That there is a violent takeover that is happening outside the buildings. Jesus said this. He said, tear down this building. He told me this some years ago, this was going to happen. And he said, tell them. He said, they can tear down this building and in 3 days I'll raise it back up. He says, my people have oftentimes found themselves stuck in buildings. He said, I keep tearing down the walls to get them to come out of hiding, to get them to come out of sleeping and comfort. I have torn down the walls and I'm tearing them down again. I'm saying, come out, nation of Jesus Christ, all across the world, so that the enemy can know that I have people in every nation. I have people, come on, I have a remnant and I have a bride that is represented in every nation. Tear down the walls and let the enemy see what he thought he was fighting against just in my community, what he thought he was coming against just my family and just us for. He says, let them know I got an army. Let them know that I'm raising up in this hour an army. This army is going to walk in revelational truth and pure power. This army that I'm raising up in this hour will reset all things back to original intent. This army that I'm raising forth in this hour will walk in synchronization and they will not break rank. This order, this army that I'm raising up will understand honor because everything in the earth will be yielded forth for them. There is a new regime. Tell the devil it's a new day and there is a new regime on the horizon. And God is tearing down the walls so you can see the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's time to see the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It's time to see the church. And as the walls come down, we're going to see that there's more with us than there are against us. There is a church of the Lord Jesus Christ because we are crossing over. We are coming out. We're no longer going to be held up under captivity. And can I just make another nugget right there as we're crossing over and we're coming out? He told them, apply the blood. Not put the blood just on your physical house, the building that you live in. Put the blood upon your heart. Put the blood in these days, put it upon your life, because what you're seeing be released as God shake us to repentance so he can recover us, so he can reset us, so he can restore us. He's shaking us to repentance, to waken us so we can see where we are off. We can see where we lost our way. We can see how long we have been from God. He's bringing us back. And so I thank God today. I thank God today that he's setting the church into an apostolic mode. He's bringing us back and he's taking us out of churchianity and he's setting us into apostolic Christianity. My mentor told me that the other day as I was looking for what is the name of what I'm sensing and feeling. Some months ago, God started dealing with me. I'm saying, God, what are we seeing? The church will not remain the same. How are you going to do this? Because this is not the church that you've shown us in the last days, as he's shown us many things. He says, I'm bringing the church out of this thing called churchianity, and I'm bringing them into this place called Christianity. Oh, yeah. He says, I'm going to do it in 3 days. That's why we're in a third day truth. We're no longer in second day knowledge. We have shifted into a third day truth. That truth houses its own economy, and it holds its own revelation of power. It is a truth that comes out of the glory dimensions, and God is raising up us in this hour. And he's saying, I'm drawing you into a place that you can sit with me, body of Christ, so you can know the original intent of who you are, so you can get back in place to fulfill what I originally called you to do. These are days of unusual things. Unusual opportunities are coming. Unusual, come on. He keeps saying unusual things. Unusual things are happening. As you move, things are going to move to you as things move out of you. As you make a step to move forward, God is going to cause you to become closer to what it was you've been waiting for. We're in a tremendous day of power. We're in a tremendous day of authority. And God is shaking everything that can be shaken because he's after you. I thank God. I have so much more to tell you, but I think my time is up. It's 8:24. I got to go. I got to get on another conference call because we have some more work to do here at the ministry. I love you. I thank God for you. I pray that you guys go and share this with somebody and let them know that we're coming back. Hopefully another night this week. I want to come back and share some things with you. I got a lot of revelation that God wants to share so you can be reset back into original light. That is the glory that gives you 8 seconds ahead of everybody else that ain't in it. Amen. That glory dimension sets us into a place that brings us ahead and not behind. You're not supposed to be average. You're supposed to be above average. And God is resetting us back into that original place of light so we can know ahead of time what he's saying and what he's doing as he's building and he's recovering new things for a new dispensation for generations to come. I'm excited to be a part of it. I know great things are happening. So I want to encourage you to be encouraged. I want you to take a moment while you have this time of being quiet and spend time with God. Let God rebirth into you so you can get your energy and strength that you need to give push, to push out and give birth to what you're pregnant with. Are y'all hearing me? Let you take this time that you're able to hear back from God. Cut off the distractions of social involvement of activities of hearing everybody else that you can't hear God. I pray that you hear God in this season because what God has given you to come forth is too important. It's too important that you don't miss it. Amen. Great days ahead. Open our eyes and let us see what God is saying. I pray y'all been blessed with this word so far. We're having shakings for the makings. I have my book here again if you have not gotten it. I'm going to be doing a whole teaching of the revelation God gave me in this book next month, and we'll be doing it virtual. We'll be letting people know we're putting the information out now so you can be a part of that teaching and that class, what we're going to be doing on this, the power of the prophetic mindset. We're going to be talking about some things that's going to deal with many things about the mind of God, the psychology of God. And so if you've been blessed today by what I've shared with you and told you, just go ahead, cash at me at $LoveGod5. Okay, you can sow, always give into the ministry. Jesus people proclaim, you know, sow seed, be a blessing to the church. We need this. We need you. Don't let us back off from each other, but let the enemy sow how we can mobilize and come together, that we resuscitate us to breathe and come back stronger than ever before. I love you, Apostle Billy, and I love you here at Jesus People Proclaim. I love you here at Cynthia Thompson Global. Go like me, Cynthia Thompson Global on Instagram. Go follow me on Facebook. Go follow me. Go to my email, my website, that we are now in the making of redoing it. But you can catch me now on Eternal Change Ministries. You can order the book there. Okay, you can go get the book there. Eternal Change Ministries. I think they're putting it up, so you can go and get that. I pray you've been blessed. I pray you've heard what God is saying, because these are the days that he's about to raise up a church that's going to walk in pure prophetic power. Write it. You're getting ready to walk in pure prophetic power. What is the prophetic? I got so much to tell you. It's the mind of God. But it's where we access the supernatural and the spiritual realms, that we are able to do mighty things in the earth on the behalf of our God. I love you. Thank you, Apostle Jackie. She said the book is phenomenal. Thank you so much. I have so much to share with you. I want to send a shout out. I just saw my little niece come on, Destiny. And I'm so grateful that you came on Destiny. She's there at Transformation. That's my family, Transformation. Michael Todd, I want to send a shout out to them. I know he's doing some new teachings, talking about who's the minister. And I think it's powerful, because who's the minister? Amen. And so we want to get an army prepared with prophetic insight. As we're ministering the gospel, let us minister it with the mind of God. Let us walk back in sheer power and put things back in their prophetic perspective and places. Amen. I love y'all. Be blessed. I pray you was blessed by that. Please share it. My time is up. I got to go. I'll be back soon. Let's stay together. Let's stay in touch, and let's walk in pure prophetic power. Tag, you it. It's your time. Go tell the world. We have come to take over. We are the kingdom and the nation of Jesus Christ. I love you. Let's go. Kingdom. Amen. God bless y'all. Bye-bye. Share.